it's book club time. And I'm jealous already because the woman sitting in front of me, her waistline is about the size of my thigh. And you would have seen her on Sky Sports. It's the wonderful Miss Georgie Thompson. And Georgie, thank you for coming in to Magic,
thank
by the way.
Thank you for having me.
Georgie's written about a subject which, I'm not going to say it's alien to me.
It's not alien to you because you partake on it.
But it's one of those subjects that you either run with it, you either take to it like a duck to water or you don't.
Yeah.
And you've obviously taken to it like a duck to water.
Well, I resisted at first.
Did you resist
for a while. Yeah, I was filming a show called A League of Their Own for Sky One.
Yeah.
And we were debating the merits and the pitfalls of Twitter. And at the time, I was absolutely against it, but I didn't really have a reason as to why. I think I just wanted to buck the trend and be a rebel and sort of not follow the crowd and the sheep on this one. But then I thought, well, if I'm going to talk about it in this vitriolic manner,
yes,
I'd better have a go and see what I think about it, really, if I try it myself. And then I found that I was totally out of the loop with everything if I wasn't on Twitter.
Absolutely.
And wasn't involved within it.
Yeah, yeah.
So as a news journalist and as somebody who is, you know, part of that whole sort of keeping up to date with current affairs and news and sport and
you
everything
have
else,
to be on
I
it.
Need to be on it.
Yeah, whether you want to or not, you work in
exactly.
the media, you have to be on
so
it.
So you might as well go head for tail and just straight in there.
Georgie Thompson, alongside Imogen Lloyd Webber, has written this book called The Twitter Diaries. It's the whole thing is Twitter. The whole thing.
Not the whole thing.
We set up, what happens is we set up the two characters. One is a sports broadcaster. Georgie says it's not her. And then we've got the shoe. Then we've got the shoe designer in New York. And Imogen is based in New York.
She is, but she's not a shoe designer. She's a political commentator.
Yeah, but she's based in New York. And then you've got all these other characters. Jake Jump Jackson. Some really, really interesting.
Like at mum?
Hello. Well, the mums, because also the mums get involved.
Yeah.
But look, before we go into the story, let's talk about why write a book, a novel, a characterisation about Twitter.
I know, I'm absolutely mad because, I mean, just writing a book is obviously a difficult enough task in its own, but I decided to write a book with Imogen, so the two of us writing together, both people who like to write anyway, and if you're a writer, you don't really like to be edited anyway because you're sort of quite protective about your text and your copy.
Yeah.
But of course, we had to edit each other throughout the duration of this book to make it make sense, really, and to make sure the story flowed because one of us was living in one location and one was living in the other.
But doesn't another location come into this? Because I called it the three M's. Melbourne to Monaco to Manhattan.
Oh, it's because this is where everything takes place. So it takes place all over the world because these girls travel. But the reality is that their worlds only collide once a year.
Right.
So on this one particular evening of this one particular year, which happens to be New Year's Eve.
New Year's Eve in NYC.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Their worlds collide, they meet, and the following day, the New York character tweets the London character, and there starts their friendship, and that's how it goes.
Well, look, just the character names. This sounds like a film. Tuesday Fields. At Tuesday Fields. You know, not Shirley Brown, or at Tuesday Fields, and at Stella Calville.
I wouldn't even be able to remember when or
where
how we came up with
it. That's what one of the things I wanted to ask.
Honestly, I wish I was more creative and could think that it came out of some amazing thought bubble that I had, but it really didn't. It was just something that we thought of, that we thought had sort of a ring to it that sounded kind of nice.
Okay, so look, the book starts with setting up the characters.
Yeah.
Because every page, I don't know if you can zoom on this, every single page is a set of tweets. It's just tweeting. What I love is you should read it from cover to cover, but you can open it anywhere and just start reading.
Oh,
so
no.
Stella says, it's quite possible that I may have started something I'm not capable of finishing. And I'm thinking, oh yeah. Tuesday goes, I'm listening. Stella, it's probably all very harmless, but what if it isn't? What? You can actually start this book anywhere, and that's what then kind of made me connect a bit with Twitter.
We didn't write that with that in mind, but it's really nice that you've picked up on that.
Because
actually,
I can go days without tweeting, and I do feel out of the loop, but then something may happen, and I feel as a music presenter, as somebody working in the media, I've got to tweet this.
Yeah.
So yesterday, my colleague Kelly and I from here, we went to see the Bad 25. Spike Lee has done this fabulous documentary about Bad, Michael Jackson's album, which is 25 years old. We got there. There's a Bad poster. We had to tweet it. Do you see what I'm saying?
Absolutely. You can dip in and out of it, and you can take as much of it or as little of it as you like. And I think that's the thing when you come to writing a book like that. For Imogen and I, we live quite similar lifestyles, and we sort of dip in and out of things all over the place. And if something catches our imagination or our attention, we sort of want to tell other people about it. And that is quite similar. And so it's almost like a series of diary extracts.
Yes.
But it's strung together from January to the following January.
So, Georgie, you yourself and Imogen could have sat down and could have written a fantastic novel, kind of, you know, Sex and the City type novel.
Yeah.
Two very high-flying women that are very, you know, into their jobs, living high lives, travelling, not unsettled, but not quite settled.
Yeah, yeah.
That would have been exciting enough, who they meet, what they do, where they eat, etc. Because you have set it up beautifully at the beginning with each character.
Yeah.
So what Tuesday does, how old she is, etc., etc.
Well, we felt we needed to give you a little bit of background.
Right. And then all of the characters, or as you put it, supporting cast. Mm. So then we get these series of tweets with Mum coming in and Jake coming in and this one come, and who's the shoe man? There's the shoe guy coming in. I'll tell you his name in a minute.
All that glitters is gold.
And supermodel 1971. Yeah. So you have this series of conversations with these very dynamic people that are just having these conversations worldwide, but via Twitter.
Yeah, and I think that's the thing about Twitter. It unites people globally, so it doesn't matter where you are in the world, you can always connect in. And that's very much part of mine and Imogen's relationship, is that she's based in New York, I'm based in London, and somehow we've maintained a friendship. And 20 years ago, that probably wouldn't have been possible other than with pen and paper and a letter.
And it would have taken
weeks, right? Yeah. But we are able to have this sort of constant dialogue and this constant chatter. I mean, I messaged her just before I came in here to speak to you to say, Angie doesn't believe it's not an autobiography. And she messaged back going, it is, it's fiction, stick to the story. And, you know, that's the sort of thing I can quickly tweet her and, you know, quicker than I can send a text. You know, it's that immediate, isn't it? It's that reciprocative, which is an incredible thing that we're able to have that sort of at our fingertips. So I think I just wanted to do something that wasn't necessarily traditional, because I don't really live in a traditional world anymore. So I was thinking about the sorts of people that react to the world in which I live in, and what makes them tick, and whether this might be something that they react to, and they so it resonates with them. And I think to a degree it does. I mean, I put it in front of my mum when I first wrote it and said, Mum, this is all in Twitter speak. And she said, well, what's Twitter?
Yeah,
and I thought, oh God, here we go. And that's the challenge. It's if we can get people to like it who aren't necessarily Twitter people, then, you know, I think we're onto something. Other than that, we rely wholly on a whole market of people that, you know, do live their lives in tweets, which we do more or less.
We do now. Let's park Tuesday and Stella aside for the moment. Let me ask you about your own personal relationship with Twitter, because you must obviously have one to have reproduced this with such passion in lines of 140 characters, sometimes a lot less.
But when I was at university, I studied broadcast journalism at university, and my tutor at the time, I remember her saying to me, anyone can write flowery language, when the real art is how you nip and tuck it to a degree where it's not libelous and it's not defamatory, but actually it says exactly what you want it to say in as sort of a smaller sentence or a shorter sentence as possible. That really is the art of writing a good tweet, isn't it? You know, it's the ability to sort of, you know, tweet one sentence in 140 characters and perhaps saying everything you need to say in that shorter period of time. And we're used to waffling on and talking and using flowery language, and this is just pinpointing exactly what you want to say in a really short, you know, sentence.
So how is your relationship with Twitter? How did it start? Well, and where is it now?
It started with me originally hating everything about it and deciding I needed to have a look into what everybody was talking about and what everybody was getting excited by. And when you're in the media world, as you are, Angie, you'll know that you have to at least subscribe partly to it, because you have to know what everybody else is talking about.
Absolutely.
And before we knew it, I mean, in more of a way, I think, even than Facebook, before we knew it, Twitter had become something that not only people were conversing in a social environment on, which is something that, you know, I obviously do with friends and family and whoever else, but it's a way of being accessible to people. So it's not just chit-chatter across the airwaves. It's actually a way of people saying to you, oh, I didn't like what you said about that today, and I really liked what you were chatting about, you know, in that particular segment of the show. And it gives you an initial immediate feedback, which for me, I think, is second to none. It's far better than waiting for somebody who is a critic to write a piece on you that might have sort of some vested interest or some agenda attached to it. This is just the ordinary Joe blog sitting at home going, I didn't like that, don't do it again.
Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
I think you have to take it at face value, and I think you have to be quite strong about it, really, and have quite a tough demeanour about it, and say, well, there are ways of looking at it.
Let me put a scenario to you. You are a TV presenter. Mm. I am lucky enough to be a radio presenter who is able to interview you. Okay, we're going to now follow each other on Twitter. Great. Yeah. As a TV presenter, there would have been a time when you would have been set apart, cut away, not accessible.
Yeah.
Now, anyone on Twitter can follow Georgie Thompson and can tell her whatever they like.
Which isn't always glowing.
is that a good thing?
I think it's...
We're not concentrating per se on that, but that's part of the Twitter package.
You don't... I still think it's the same debate we have with television these days, or with any form of media we have. You can opt in and opt out. You don't have to look at all the mentions.
Right.
You don't have to, okay, so there are tweets that you may not like. You can block people if they're offensive. You can report them if they get worse. There are ways to deal with it if you really feel uncomfortable with it. Or just get off it if you really hate it and you can't stand it. You know, there's a lot of... There's a lot of posturing about Twitter, I think, but people use it for their own devices and their own manipulations. And I think you have to be realistic about what you're using it for and what you appreciate, you know, within that. And take it at face value, because you will get extreme viewpoints on it, and they can sometimes pinch and hurt.
Cut.
And they can. they can really cut. I mean, one of the things that I've always been teased about is my height, because I'm little. So that's always something that, you know, people will find to have a go at. And as long as they're not absolutely foul, then I'll laugh along with anyone about it. Because, you know, if you can't laugh at yourself, what on earth can you do?
Mm.
So as long as you're self-deprecating to a certain degree, I think you can stomach it. I think the problem is when you believe your own publicity,
it's a big
old wake-up call when somebody doesn't go along with it.
And I so agree with you. If you can't laugh at yourself, when others do, it does. It cuts, doesn't it?
See, I think that's the whole point of why Imogen and I think, wrote that book, is because... we felt very strongly that there are so many other girls out there like us who deal with all these different issues in their 30s, with, you know, parents getting on their backs about what they should or shouldn't be doing, and, you know, where the career is going, and at what point you sort of say, well, what takes precedent over, you know, something else, and all sorts of different debates going on for somebody, for a girl in their 30s. And we thought, well, let's write about what we know about, which is our own life experiences. And while I promise you the stories in there aren't reflective of my own experiences,
I ain't saying a word.
the thinking behind it is very much about let's write something about what we know and hope that other people relate to it, because that's how we feel.
Yeah. One of the things that I wasn't sure about, let me tell you my Twitter story.
Yes.
Signed up for Twitter, and the first person that followed me told me they wanted to go toilet. So I didn't think that this would I just didn't think it was for me. Do you understand?
I understand.
What I did like was being accessible, or finding out what Barack Obama was thinking, what is Piers Morgan thinking, what is Alan Sugar thinking. Speaking of which, Piers Morgan and Alan Sugar used to have some real serious Twitter fights. Yeah. I mean, I knew it was all in jest. And it was great, and I used to love really watching them. But Piers has actually endorsed this book, hasn't he? But he hasn't slated you girls yet, has he?
Well, no. What he did say was that it was...
hideously addictive.
Yeah, well, you know the quote.
Entertaining, and I don't know whether to consult my lawyer or my shrink.
Well, the reason for this being is because Piers was the mutual friend that Imogen and I met through.
Who isn't in this book? Carry on.
Well, actually... So I was at a party on New Year's Eve, and it was his party, and Imogen and I met through him, and everyone else was fawning all over Piers and everything else, and we just got on so well as two pretty down-to-earth normal girls, and had a great old time together over the course of sort of dinner and the rest of the evening. And so he really was responsible for putting us together in the first place, right, which is what we told him some months later when we'd started writing the story arc for the book and warned him what was coming next. And he sort of said, oh, how afraid do I need to be?
Oh.
Like, very afraid, Piers, very afraid. What he finds more disturbing about anything is that we describe a character in that book that isn't dissimilar to him, called At PMTV, as a benevolent uncle to the girls.
As I say... Georgie's here in the UK, Imogen is in New York, and they met at a party. But it's not autobiographical.
No, but the funny thing is, it's what started the whole thing off. So the book begins with those two characters,
nice,
Stella Cavill and Tuesday Fields, meeting in this environment. And then after that, it's our imaginations, right? But the funny thing is once we'd finished writing that book, we were over here talking about what to do next and what would happen next with our publishers. And... the funniest thing happened. We'd had meetings all week, and we'd got to the end of the week, and we'd sort of forgotten to ask each other what we were doing at the weekend. I knew that Imo was flying back to New York, and I was going off to France to cover a Grand Prix, and so we knew we were going in separate directions, but neither of us had talked about when we were going or what we were doing. And it was Sunday night, and I promise you, you could hear a pin drop in Heathrow Terminal 5, which is written about at length in that book, because there are things that happen within it. And it was in Heathrow Terminal 5, and I'm getting the escalators up the stairs in one way, in one direction.
Down.
And I honestly looked over to my left and thought, no way is that Imogen. And it was, and she was catching the escalators down the other way. And we both looked across each other, and she said to me, you know what this is? And I said, yeah, it's the start of the next book. This is how we start our next book. And it was such a ridiculous coincidence. But that sort of is the nature of what's happened since we've met and the experiences we've had. And in the book, we write our acknowledgements at the end, which we both cried over and like complete babies. And she sort of, I said about her that she's my friend that hasn't just, she doesn't just know all my best stories, but she's lived them with me.
Yeah.
And we had a year whilst we were writing the book, where all these experiences kept happening, and we just kept saying, we'll chuck that in, and we'll chuck that in, and we'll over-exaggerate that a little bit. And all these things just kept happening. And it was just as a result of, you know, two people being brought together. And when you don't know each other that well, because we didn't at that point, and we'd started collaborating on a joint sort of artistic project together, you don't really know how it's going to pan out. And we were just really lucky. We just got really, really lucky that we ended up with, you know, great friendship as well as a book.
A great book. And in a very, very strange way, you're reading it, and even though they're tweets, sometimes I'm going, even though it's just a tweet, and then other times I'm going, no. It really does tell a story, and it really does use the art of Twitter. It really, really does. And it's a very interesting read. A Tale of Two Cities, One Friendship, and 140 Characters. Tuesday Fields and Stella Cavill, I think, Georgie Thompson and Imogen Lloyd-Webber. It's called The Twitter Diaries. Georgie, thanks for coming in.
Pleasure. Thank you for having me.
It's been a pleasure.